Let's go to California, where Howie Klein is standing by. He's the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. They raise money for progressive and sometimes socialist candidates. Read him all the time over at Down With Tyranny. You are talking on Down With Tyranny about what seems like a landslide in 2020. That's what I'm picking up, that you think this is the end of Trump and maybe, perhaps, the Republican Party as we know it?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't know if it's the end of the Republican Party as we know it, maybe for a few years. I mean, you know, it was the end of the Republican Party as we knew it when FDR was president. Mm-hmm. And they just went into eclipse for quite a long time. They were no longer, for years, they were no longer anything. They had so few members in the Senate and so few members in the House that they were irrelevant. There were factions in the Democratic Party that had more relevance than the Republican Party.
Yeah.
And I don't know if I see that. And if I do, I see it as a temporary thing. You know, I don't doubt that the Democrats will blow it. And, you know, if the Democrats wind up, you know, with another crap, mediocre president like Biden, then in 2022 will be a huge year for the Republicans. You know, I hope Bernie winds up winning and lots of progressives wind up winning and they actually try to do something. But you know, if Biden were to drop dead today, it should only happen on his tombstone. It should say, nothing fundamentally will change. I mean, what could be a better way of summing this guy up?
Yeah. Yeah. That's what he told the billionaires. If you vote for me, nothing will change. Talk to
nothing
me.
Will fundamentally nothing will change. That's how he is. That's what his campaign is about.
Right.
He's telling him, don't be worried. I won't change anything. Forget about that crazy Bernie and that crazy Elizabeth Warren. Nothing's changing. Everything's going to be all going to be happy. No one's taxes are going up. Don't worry. Don't worry. Don't worry.
So there are two things I wanted you to talk about up front. One is Trump's toxicity. And is it getting to the point where the entire Senate is going to abandon him in order to save their own hide? And I also wanted to ask you about Roosevelt, because you wrote about Roosevelt and how the more Republicans try to tarnish him with the label of socialist, the more he won.
Right. They weren't only tarnishing Roosevelt. They were tarnishing the Democratic Party. And they were so stupid that they kept doing it for a decade before one of them thought, you know, this isn't working for us. Mm-hmm. I mean, Roosevelt was winning by the biggest landslides in history. I mean, by the end, the Republicans were down to two tiny states that they managed to win. And there were 17 Republicans left in the Senate. There were 77 or 88 Republicans left in the House. And they kept yelling and screaming socialism. And by the end, there were so few of them that no one even heard their ranting and raving about socialism. It wasn't working. Mm-hmm. And they're doing the same thing now. I talked to you know, guys from the NRCC. And they don't get it. And I've even sent them the stuff that I've written about it, you know, which is very factual, goes election by election by election. You know, they lost 100 seats and then they lost 30 seats. And, you know, they went from like being the dominant party to being practically non-existent. And these folks don't care. They do every single press release that goes out, every time they get in front of an audience, they say they call the Democrats socialists. Either they're like, you know, best friends with Nancy Pelosi or best friends with AOC, or they're you know, living in sin with Ilhan Omar. I mean, these people are insane. So this morning,
can I just interrupt you for 1 second? The thing that blew me away over at Down With Tyranny, you write that when Roosevelt ran for re-election the third time, who did he pick as his vice president?
Well, he picked a real socialist. I mean,
yeah.
The Republicans were screaming about socialism. He said, hey, let's give him something to really scream about. turn, and he picked Henry Wallace, who actually was a socialist.
Yeah.
The conservative Democrats went even more insane about this than the Republicans. Or I don't know if they went more insane, but there were more of them. There were more conservative Democrats, so there was a louder insanity, and they really had it in for Wallace. They didn't want him in there, and they were able to make sure that Roosevelt wouldn't use him the fourth time, and they put in a more moderate Democrat, not a conservative Democrat, but a moderate Democrat, who wound up being the president, Harry Truman.
Right.
It would have been Wallace.
Right. Are you saying that if the Democrats went full socialist, because they're, you know, even Bernie is hedging his bets, I'm a Democratic socialist, just full socialist, how would they do? Of those 100 million who don't vote but could, how many of them are socialists?
Well, I don't know that they are socialists, but what the polling is showing is that they love socialists. Policy, and that they think that the ways that socialists want to change the government would be helpful to them and their families, and they're right about that, and I think it would help. But, you know, who knows? That's just me talking.
Right. I interrupted you, so you were saying you were talking.
I was saying that this morning when I was working on this thing, you asked me about Trump's toxicity.
Right.
So I called a bunch of candidates, and I asked them what they thought would happen if Trump were to campaign in terms of the House in their districts, in terms of the Senate in their states, and you know what would it mean to them? Are they nervous about it? I'm talking to people. For example, Teresa Tomlinson is a Democrat from Macon, Georgia. She was the mayor of Macon, Georgia until very recently, and she's running for the U.S. Senate. Against Perdue, who's a Trump crony, and there's no question that Trump will be campaigning in Georgia. Georgia is going to be a swing state in this election. It leans red, but it's Democrats feel they have a shot there. She's going to be, if she's winds up there's like 20 Democrats running in the primary. If she winds up as the candidate, she'll be a very, very formidable opponent to Perdue. So I said, what's going to happen when Trump comes? Does that scare you? Does it make you nervous? He won the state. And you want me to read her response?
Yeah.
So what she said is Trump is underwater in Georgia. Some, you know, polls have him at 37% positive, 43% negative. And she said, I think it's fine. Have him come down. It allows me to draw the distinction between government that harms the people through his crazy trade wars, she called them tariff wars, inept administration of government, like the Hurricane Michael relief, faux conservatism that has ballooned our budget to several trillion dollars and keeps our rural areas without health care. I, in contrast, I know how to govern well and have a record to prove it. They can't compete with that. The people of Georgia have been gut-punched by Trump and his Republican ilk, and I intend to point that out every day. So that was basically the answer that everyone gave. I mean, Andrew Romanoff from Colorado, he didn't go on as long, but he said, it helps. Glad to have Cory pictured on stage with him. Cory Gardner, who Andrew will be running against, the Republican incumbent. They all said pretty much the same thing, that Trump coming into their districts or into their states to campaign just helps them. It helps to draw the distinction. I mean, Trump is a buffoon who is getting government all wrong. He's unable to get anything done, thank God. And Teresa Tomlinson, several years in a row, was among America's five best mayors. Mm-hmm. So she's the opposite of that. She's someone who got everything done, who just, you know, ran two terms of incredible administration in Macon, Georgia. So of course she's delighted to not just go against a sitting senator, Sonny Perdue. I think it's Sonny Perdue. It's one of the Perdues, but also to bring Trump into it. She feels that Trump will be helpful in her race, and everyone else who I spoke to, you know, six or seven people, they all said the same thing. Yes, Trump is a net positive for them, and they and the ones who don't necessarily expect him to come to their congressional districts are hoping that he does.
Right. So I was trying to remember why I voted for Obama and why I loved him. And it was after George W. Bush, Obama was running on competence. That was what I thought, oh, we need somebody in the Oval Office who knows what he's doing. We've got Hurricane Dorian. By the time this airs, I don't know what the death toll will be. Trump has shown himself to be incompetent. Puerto Rico is an example of his incompetence.
He blames the hurricanes on Puerto Ricans. I mean, when will it end? He said that. He's talking about Puerto Rico, and he said, when will it end? As though they're bringing on the hurricanes, and, you know, he can't stand what they're doing to him.
Which is what the Republicans kind of did to the African Americans in Louisiana after Katrina. They blamed it on the blacks. They blamed it on welfare. They literally said, we've trained an entire generation of African Americans to be so incompetent they can't get out of the way of a hurricane. That's what Republicans...
One of the religious nuts today, so it wasn't Falwell... what was his name? He's one of the big ones. One of the, you know, the big five of the complete religious psychos. He was asked on Fox and Friends about all these gun massacres, and he had no question about what was causing it. It was the teaching of
evolution.
That's exactly right. Yeah. He said, you know, if you teach evolution, you're going to get these massacres. That's it.
And he's not going to evolve on gun control. Well, let's talk about The Family. It's running on Netflix.
I'm watching it on Netflix.
Do you recommend it? Should people watch it?
Well, I think so. I mean, the reason I say I think so is because I read the book, the first of his books, and loved it. I just loved that book. But I read it a lot, many, many years ago. So now I'm watching the TV show, and a lot of times I don't like watching a TV show if I've watched the book because the book is so much better. But this was so long ago that I read the book when it first came out and loved it, and now it's, you know, many years hence, and the TV show works for me really well. I'm enjoying it. I'm only on the second episode, but it's better than Stitzel.
I watched a little of Stitzel. It's brilliant. You just reminded me. I have to go back and finish it. With The Family, that is an actual organization of evangelical Christians who feather their own political and economic nests by...
Yeah, there's different ways to describe them. You know, they would certainly not describe it the way you just did. They didn't see themselves even... as religious. They saw, you know, what their claim was is that they were just followers of Jesus, but not of Christianity per se, which is very attractive, you know, especially attractive to, you know, it's a way to reach many, many people who are from diverse religions, which is that what they were doing. What they were seeking was power in Washington. So, you know, you can't alienate the Catholics or the Jews just to go after evangelical Christians. You don't want to even alienate mainline Christians. So they worked it in a way that it worked for their own good.
They invented, you know, the prayer breakfast that Eisenhower didn't want to go to because he felt it violated separation of church and state, but he did it anyway.
And it's still on. I mean, they still have that prayer breakfast. I'm assuming that the guy Doug Coe, who ran the whole operation and put on the breakfast, I'm assuming he must be dead. I haven't looked it up yet, but I'm guessing he's not running the thing anymore.
Right.
But Family still exists. I mean, they're huge Trump backers, of course, as you would guess. And yeah.
So it's worth watching.
I would say.
Yeah, Jerry Falwell Jr., his father blamed 9/11 on the adulterers and the sodomites and the homosexuals. How can he not be gay? Every son rebels against his father. He's Jerry Falwell Jr.
Well, we don't really know if he's gay. Let me just lay it out and let people decide on their own.
Okay.
So, and if you want to see the pictures, by the way, they're all up on Down with Tyranny.
Okay.
So Jerry Falwell Jr. has a gorgeous, hunky pool boy. you know, I think 23, mm-hmm. and gives him a couple of million dollars to buy a gay brothel, basically. So, but does that mean that he's gay?
In Florida.
Yeah, in Florida.
Yeah.
I mean, the guy, you know, he gives the guy, you know, it's a 23-year-old guy who gives him a few million dollars, and the guy buys a gay brothel with it, but it doesn't mean that Falwell Jr. is gay.
Right. I thought it was a hostel, like a youth hostel, that Falwell discovered was being used as a gay brothel.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, right. They could say whatever they want to say, call it whatever they want to call it, but right. A hostel. Or a gay brothel or whatever. Then it turns out, as this guy started getting a little bit older, it turns out that Jerry Falwell wanted someone younger again, and he has a personal trainer who he says helped him lose 60 pounds. Mm. And then he didn't give $2 million of his own money to this guy, but $2 million of the church's money to the guy. So this story has been buried in financial, you know, it's become like a financial misappropriation story. Right. Although the guy who broke it, the Reuters reporters, it was very easy to read in between the lines, where they had the same thoughts that you did, that Jerry Falwell Jr. was a homo.
Right.
And it's obvious. I mean, again, you know, pictures of both the pool boy and of the personal trainer, they're both on my blog. You can see the photos and show them on the radio. Everyone has very, very shiny white teeth.
Mm.
And, you know, I don't know. That's a lot of money. Doesn't right. cost that much. Maybe he was also buying Hustlers for $50, but, you know, $2 million, you must be getting something good out of that.
Is this what Michael Cohen was helping him with?
Yes, with one of them, they needed to cover it up. So I think it was part of the deal for Trump to get evangelical support.
Right.
That he would have Cohen, who was Trump's fixer at the time, fix this whole thing and make it go away. There apparently were pictures. Even to this day, Cohen denies that there was any inappropriate sex. He says there's a story there, but it wasn't a sexual story. Samantha Bee kind of picked up on that. I think she jumped a little bit too fast into it's not gay, it's not gay, it's not gay. I think she's wrong, she's wrong, she's wrong. But that's just my opinion. What do I know?
Right. And Jerry Falwell Jr. is not a minister. He's just a lawyer, I think.
Yeah, and he's a businessman. He heads up university. And, you know, he's a lay Christian.
Yes.
Who was... by pool boys. I don't know that for sure. I mean, you know, I guess there's a way to read this story and say, hey, you know, it wasn't really about the sex.
Okay.
Maybe.
All right.
Possible.
You wrote about our quote-unquote meritocracy. We believe in America that if you work hard, you can get ahead, and that they've opened up the floodgates at the Ivy Leagues to allow anybody in, so we're told.
Not but anybody.
Based on your intelligence, that when you look at the Ivy League, when you look at the Harvard...
Right. So it's not anybody. It's based on, you know, hard work, intelligence, sometimes still a little bit connections, but it's not... It used to be based on blood.
Right.
So it's not that anymore.
But we're now discovering... that this meritocracy that we're being... It starts in kindergarten. The pipeline. Talk to me about the pipeline and how it's really not a meritocracy.
Well, it is partially a meritocracy. But, you know, this guy Brewster, who was the...
Kingman Brewster.
He was the president of Yale when I was a student. And he was, he was the last of the Yale... presidents to, you know, just think it was just fine to just have the sons and of former Yaleys come to Yale. That's the way it always has been, and that's the way it always would be in his mind. But after that, they changed it, and it suddenly was, you know, as you said, they wanted to do a meritocracy instead, which was going to be based on grades. Well, now, generations later, what's happening is the people who went to Yale, they're putting their children into from kindergarten on into these schools that are training them hard to be able to make it into Yale. And to get for all of the reasons that one would want to go to Yale, which isn't necessarily the pursuit of knowledge. It's the pursuit of social status and wealth
and power.
And yes, and power. And the idea here is that there's a part in the story that I wrote which goes into the details of, you know, what percent of these kids who are put through this go insane, become drug addicts. You know, wipe themselves out, etc., which is a way, I guess, of winnowing the field. So you only get the best people. The rest of them are in mental institutions.
Mm-hmm.
But what it really is, you know, it was going down from father to son. Now it's going down from parent to children, based on something other than based on a different kind of a system, where they actually have to perform at a different level. And you know what that level is to society, and what that's going to mean for society is being played out right now. And the people who are looking at it most closely are very worried that it's not a good thing.
You gave some kind of number where Harvard's class, something like the vast majority of the graduates are children of parents who earn more than $200,000 a year.
Yeah, that's right, the vast majority, because they otherwise they wouldn't get into the kind of private schools that are feeding into Harvard.
Right.
Whether
right.
that, you know, kindergarten, elementary school, high school, you know, those are all their high school, even kindergartens. Hey, we're going to send our four-year-old to a kindergarten where X percent go to Harvard.
Right, right. When Brett Kavanaugh...
Another percent go to a mental institution.
Yes. I was just going to bring that up, because when Brett Kavanaugh's nomination was before us, he was talking about how hard he worked to get into Yale and how big a brain he has. And the truth is, he had a rich father who was a lobbyist, and he went to this elite private school before he went off to Yale Law School. And studies show that and this is really hard to believe, but you're more likely to find a drug addict in an elite private school or an elite public school than you are in, say, a public school down in South Central or in the South Bronx. Drug addiction is higher in elite private schools than it is in...
A lot of them are the ones who don't then go on to Yale and Princeton and Harvard. Not all of them. Some of them do.
Yeah.
But a lot of those are the ones who just, you know, they flip out, they use drugs, they act out, and they don't make it. And that's part of the winnowing system. I mean, that's actually part of the system.
It's part of the system, and it breeds a type of mind that's competitive, that doesn't believe... That we're not, that breeds a mind that believes we're not all in it together.
Right. And, you know, a kind of a bizarro function of that is you get someone like Trump, who vaguely, you know, spent a year and a half in the business school of one of these Ivy League schools. He wasn't really in an Ivy League school, and he got in, he didn't get in on any kind of normal basis. He got in because his brother was a friend of the admissions officer, and his father gave a lot of money. But in any case, look what's happening with China now. I mean, he is insane. This guy, I mean, you talk about competitive, he's going to bring the country down. The rural counties that voted most heavily for Trump in 2016 are suffering more than any other counties. Trump did better in the soybean growing belt than any other place in the country. He had more voters in those counties. So the soybean industry is gone from the United States. Not just is it gone now, it's gone forever. It's never coming back. It's over. Bye-bye. All the soybean farmers are losing their farms. There's a bump in suicide rates now. Bankruptcies are way up. And these are the people that voted most for Trump. And he's destroyed them because he's competitive with the president of China. What he's doing makes no sense.
He's
doing it anyway, because of this crazy competitiveness.
Have the Chinese weaponized our political system? Are they isolating districts in terms of imports and exports? Are they, did they weaponize soybeans, for example, to punish Trump electorally?
Yeah, well, I mean, there was a lot of talk that they were doing exactly that. But there's almost no way that they could have done this without going for soybeans. I mean, whether they wanted to cause Trump pain or not, soybeans were one of the big. They were. They're not anymore, but they were one of the biggest imports have from the United States.
Okay, very quickly before you go, I've. Two more topics I want to ask you.
Funny that you should ask me before I go, because I don't know if you hear the clicking on the phone right now.
Yes.
But the person who keeps calling me is a friend of yours who made a film about you and wants to make a film about me. And I told him not to call while we have this interview. And now he's called. Like, this is, like, I think the third time he's calling since we started talking.
I wanted to ask you about... Well, we can hold off on slavery for next week. Great Britain, there's going to be possibly a snap election. What's going on in Great Britain?
Wait, it looks like everybody kind of thinks that, you know, it's time. So, you know, Boris Johnson was not elected prime minister. He was basically the bigwigs in his own party, the insiders in the Conservative Party. They're the only ones that got to vote in this thing. Regular people didn't get to vote, and they picked him, and he is now the prime minister. They should really call him acting prime minister, but they don't. And he wants to do this thing called a hard Brexit. So that means that even if they can't get an agreement with the European Union on leaving, they're going to leave anyway. On Halloween. Mm-hmm. So that's the date he says he's leaving, Halloween. And Labour and the Lib Dems and a sizable number of conservatives, so definitely a majority. So a majority of the country for sure, and a majority of the House of Commons also, don't agree with this. They don't want it to happen. So today they are going to do what's effectively a vote of no confidence. Now, they're not calling it a vote of no confidence. They're going to put off a vote on Brexit, which Boris Johnson has already said this is in effect a vote of no confidence if this passes. And if that happens, he will call a snap election, and then it'll be up to the British people to make a decision. And basically, the decision is going to be not just who they want to govern the country, but it's going to be, will there be Brexit or not? And I have every reason to believe that they're going to pick not, because Brexit won by a very, very, very small plurality, and only in England, minus London. It lost in London, it lost in Scotland, it lost in Wales, it lost in Northern Ireland.
It's Trump.
So it's just really part of England where it did well in some of the economically disturbed areas that were getting bombarded by on the internet by the Russians, the same way they did that for Trump here. They were doing it there for Brexit. So I have no reason to believe that if they do call a snap election and Brexit is the issue, which it will be, that there will be no Brexit after all.
Right,
have a second referendum.
Yeah, like Trump, the people who voted for Brexit say, I didn't think it would actually win.
Just stop after the first think. I didn't think.
Jeremy Corbyn, do we like Jeremy Corbyn?
I love Jeremy Corbyn. He makes, he has hurt himself with certain, by giving the media ammunition to use against him. I think he's great. I see a lot of similarities between him and Bernie. And the same way that the corporate media hates Bernie, they hate him even more.
Right. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. They raise money for progressive and sometimes socialist candidates around America. Read him every day over at Down With Tyranny. We'll talk to you next week, sir.
Yes, but don't go away.
Oh, why?
Well, this isn't, I don't want this to be recorded.
Oh, okay. Stay on the line. Thank you.